must have been another country. Yes, it must have been another land. That couldn't happen in the USA. We'd never treat a man that way. Oh, I know we'd never treat a man that way.
Your orders are to stop Marconi. Marconi must not reach his destination. Do you understand? Don't screw this up!
My name is Michael Marconi. Everyone calls me Marconi. What I'm about to share with you will expose a high-level New World Order secret government that operates in the shadows that most Americans are not even aware of. It is an organization that honors no borders and operates throughout the world. This secret organization conducts illegal surveillance operations against unsuspecting citizens like you and me. This is where my story begins. Woodhall Hospital, Brooklyn, New York, December 5th, 2 p.m. in the afternoon. As Michael Marconi prepares to enter the revolving doors to the hospital, he notices a black helicopter overhead. The hospital lobby is filled with people sitting on couches. Doctors and nurses are walking into the coffee shop entrance. Marconi now walks towards the customer service desk to speak to the receptionist sitting behind the counter. The receptionist is a young Hispanic woman with long black hair in her early 20s.
"How may I help you?" she asks.
"I'm here to get a pass to see my mother, Martha Marconi, and my brother, Robert Marconi." The receptionist checks her computer terminal for the room number. She then takes out a yellow pass and hands it to Marconi. "Your mother is on the third floor in room 323, and your brother Robert is in the psychiatric ward on the fifth floor." Marconi thanks the receptionist and walks over the security area, where he shows the police officer the pass and then shows him his photo identification before walking over to the nearest elevator. Marconi gets on the elevator with other visitors and then pushes the number 3 button on the elevator and waits to get off at his floor. Martha Marconi's hospital room, 323. Michael Marconi walks into the hospital room and sees his mother on a respirator machine. A nurse is attending to his mother. There is a woman sitting in a chair next to his mother's bed. Pat Rieger, a woman in her late 50s with gray hair wearing a dark shirt and white blouse, smiles when she sees Michael.
"You must be Michael."
"Yes, I'm Michael. We've spoken many times over the telephone."
Marconi glances over at his mother lying in the hospital bed, who appears to be sleeping.
"How's my mother doing?"
"Your mom has been very sick. She has pneumonia.
I got here as fast as I could."
"Your mother told me you were coming."
"I should have been here a day earlier."
Michael walks over to the bed and takes his mother's hand. He then kisses her on the forehead. His mother opens her eyes and stares at her son. Martha Marconi, age 80, with fair complexion and light brown hair, tries to speak.
"Thank God you're here."
Michael kneels by the side of his mother's bed.
"I got here as soon as I could.
I got very sick and had to be rushed to the hospital."
"You look very weak."
"The social worker is on her way to see you. She has papers for you to sign, son. I'm giving you permission to any decisions about my health care while I'm here at the hospital."
"I understand, Mom."
A fair-complexioned woman in her 40s with blonde hair enters the room carrying a file folder.
"You must be Michael. I have some forms for you to sign."
The woman places the forms on the table and points to where it needs to be signed. Michael Marconi takes out a pen from his jacket pocket and initials the paperwork. The social worker hands Marconi his copy in an envelope.
"It was a pleasure meeting you, Mr. Marconi." The social worker now leaves the room with the folder. Martha Marconi closes her eyes and goes back to sleep. Michael leans over and kisses his mother on the forehead.
"I guess now that your mother is sleeping, you'll be heading upstairs to get your brother out of the hospital."
"Yes, I'm going upstairs right now."
"I visited your brother last night, and he was so excited that you were coming today to take him home. All he talks about is coming home so he can have a cigarette."
He hasn't had a cigarette in over 2 months. He's probably going stir crazy. You know your brother pretty well.
That I do. It was a pleasure meeting you, Miss Rieger. Marconi grabs his belongings and heads out the door.
Woodall Hospital, 5th floor, psychiatric unit. Michael Marconi is standing in front of a locked metal door. A male attendant opens the door and Marconi enters. They both walk a short way to another door. The attendant pulls out a key from his pocket and unlocks the second door. Marconi follows behind the male attendant towards the main desk. Marconi now looks around the psychiatric unit and sees people watching television sets and also nurses attending to patients while patients are walking around the unit floor.
A black woman, approximately 28 years old, who is a social worker, approaches Marconi and introduces herself.
Hi, I'm Melissa. You must be Robert's brother. We're expecting you.
Yes, I'm Robert's older brother.
We just need to get you to sign Robert's discharge papers.
Okay, Marconi answers.
Marconi follows the social worker to her office, but before he can enter the office, he is stopped by his brother.
Robert Marconi, age 54, a heavy-set balding white man with salt and pepper gray hair, taps his brother on the shoulder.
Michael, I'm glad you're here. I want to go home. Let's go.
Michael smiles and turns and answers, Hi, Robert. I just have to sign your discharge papers. As soon as I sign your discharge papers, we can leave.
Michael enters the social worker's office and signs the papers. The social worker puts the discharge papers into an envelope and hands them to Marconi. Marconi shakes the social worker's hand and walks back over to nurse's station. Melissa hands Marconi a bag filled with Robert's medication.
A male attendant escorts Michael and Robert to the exit door of the psychiatric unit. The attendant opens the door and allows them to exit before slamming the metal door behind them and using his key to lock the door.
A couple minutes later, in front of the Woodall Hospital front entrance area, Marconi hands his brother a pack of Newport cigarettes.
Robert breaks open the pack of cigarettes and takes a cigarette from the box and lights a cigarette. After taking a long drag on his cigarette, he sarcastically asks Michael a question.
Who made up that no-smoking rule in the hospital anyway?
I think it was the mayor, Robert.
That mayor Bumberg is an asshole.
I guess you're going to have to take it up with City Hall, Robert.
Why are prices for cigarettes so high?
You got me, Robert. Why don't you ask the mayor?
Who elected that guy anyway?
I say a lot of non-smokers, Robert.
Michael, put on your coat. Let's go. We got to get out of here.
Robert, please. You need to calm down.
Michael, I feel dizzy.
Robert, I'm going to call an ambulance to take you to the hospital.
Marconi picks up the telephone and calls for help.
Michael, please, we have to get out of here tonight. It's not safe. They're going to kill us.
Michael hugs his brother until the ambulance arrives. Within 15 minutes, Michael hears a knock on the front door. Michael opens the front door and allows two police officers to enter the apartment.
Did you call for an ambulance?
Yes, it's for my brother.
What's the problem?
My brother is acting delusional.
Does your brother have a medical condition?
Yes, a very long history. The emergency medical unit arrives and enters the apartment. Marconi escorts the men into his brother's bedroom. The emergency medical personnel begin checking Robert's vital signs. Marconi and the police officers stand in the background and watch. Robert begins ranting and raving.
You have to help us! Somebody's trying to kill us! They tried to run my brother over with a car!
The EMS worker places Robert into a wheelchair and secures the seatbelt around his waist. The worker then wheels Robert out the front door of the apartment.
There are helicopters everywhere. They're outside of our window. My brother Michael's in danger. If he stays in the apartment, someone's going to try and kill him. Please, help my brother. I don't want to see him die.
As Robert is being wheeled towards the elevator, the police officer walks over to Marconi and starts a conversation.
He was rambling that someone was trying to kill his brother.
Don't pay any attention to that officer.
He said that someone was after you and trying to run you over with a car. He also said there are helicopters outside of the building.
Marconi pauses before answering the police officer. He said that? Wow, what a story.
You did the right thing calling for an ambulance.
Yeah, I could tell by the way he was sweating that something was wrong.
Well, the EMS attendant thinks your brother may have suffered a heart attack. Well, good night, Mr. Marconi.
Thanks for your help, officer.
Good night.
Marconi closes the front door to the apartment and takes a seat at the kitchen table and stares at the walls. Marconi then lowers his head and then nervously uses both hands to comb his hair. Woodhull Hospital, early the next day. The medical intensive care unit, 8th floor, room number 120. Marconi walks up to the door of his brother's hospital room. There is a nurse sitting at a desk guarding the door. His brother is lying awake in his bed, hooked up to a heart monitor. A black female nurse, age 40, with long black hair, wearing a white uniform, turns to ask Marconi a question. Robert hears his brother talking to the nurse. He sits up in bed and waits until his brother enters the room. Robert whispers something in his brother's ear. Robert then turns and yells out to the female nurse, who is outside of the room.
Can you close the door? It's confidential. My brother and I need to talk.
I'm sorry, Robert. I can't close the door. The door has to stay open. It's for your own safety. I'm here to make sure nothing bad happens to you.
Why, I couldn't get you on the telephone. I called the operator and had to connect me to the police department.
What did you tell him?
I told the police that someone was trying to kill you. They wanted to know who the person was.
What name did you give him?
I told him that it was President George Scherf that was out to get you. I wanted to have him arrested and put in jail for trying to kill you.
So what happened next?
They wanted to know my name so they could have me arrested.
Giving you a telephone, Robert, is like handing you a loaded weapon.
Nurse, I need to make a telephone call. I have to call Washington. They need to ground all the helicopters. The government's trying to kill my brother.
Who wants to kill your brother? Robert leans over and speaks softly to his brother.
Michael, I want you to buy a car. I give you $500 to buy a car. If you can get me out of here, you don't even have to pay me back.
I'll think about it, Robert.
Michael, can we move to a country where cigarettes are $2 a pack?
Yes, Robert.
Where can we go?
How about Italy, Robert?
Will they send my checks there?
I don't see why not.
Do they have American TV over there?
I'm sure they do, Robert.
Are we going to fly or take a boat to get there? I've never been on a plane before.
How do you want to go?
Michael, let's go by boat. Do you think the Krauts are trying to sink the boat on the way to Italy?
I hope not, Robert. The war's been over a long time.
Okay, then, let's go.
Robert, excited by the news, yells out to the nurse at the door.
Nurse, get my clothes. My brother and I are leaving.
Where do you think you're going?
I'm going to Italy so I can get cigarettes for $2 a pack.
You can't leave without the doctor's permission. Robert now yells out to the nurse.
I want to go home. Get my clothes. I'm leaving.
The nurse enters the room to calm Robert down. Robert, I'm sorry, but you can't leave the hospital without seeing the doctor first. That's the hospital's rules.
My brother Michael owns the hospital. He says I can go home now.
Why don't you have dinner first, Robert?
I don't want any hospital food. I'm sick of hospital food. I'm Italian. I want some Italian food.
They're serving chicken for dinner.
Michael, can you get some spaghetti before we leave? Maybe we can go get some spaghetti in the restaurant downstairs before we go home, please.
A female nurse enters the room to take a blood sample.
Hello, Mr. President. I'm going to need to get a blood sample from you. It won't take long.
Okay.
The nurse draws a tube of blood from Robert's right arm.
If there's a war, I'll send out battleships, the Marines, the Air Force, the Navy, the Army, and the Reserves. That's what I'm going to do to stop the war.
You certainly know what to do, Robert.
Michael, do you want me Vice President?
I'll think about it, Robert.
Michael, if you're the Vice President, you can change the law. You can put President Scherf in jail. Scherf doesn't need to have a trial. Make it so he never gets out.
It's not a bad idea, Robert.
Michael, two guys tried to kill me throwing a brick off the roof. Can you put him in jail?
I'll have them locked up and throw away the key. They'll never get out, Robert.
Give me a pack of cigarettes, Michael. A container of coffee and a donut. And I'll be ready to leave by the time you get back.
The female nurse now steps in. Robert, I'll be right back with your medication. In less than a minute, the female nurse returns with Robert's medication. She hands Robert a glass of water with the pills. Robert puts the pills in his mouth and takes a drink of the water and swallows the pills. Within a few minutes, Robert is fast asleep.
I still can't believe how we met, Michael. Pretty amazing, wasn't it, Raina? Who would believe that I'd be listening to you being interviewed by George Norrie on Coast to Coast AM about a legend, and that I would contact you by email, and a couple of months later, you would be here having breakfast with me. Yes, that is definitely a stretch of the imagination, Raina. You know, Michael, I've been a long-time Art Bell Coast to Coast listener. I thought your interview with George Norrie was one of the best I had ever heard. I was fascinated by the story about the legend of J.C. Brown, and after listening to the show, I decided to send you an email. I never thought you would really respond to my email. Well, Raina, when I got your email, I was surprised by the fact you wanted to send me a CD of an old Art Bell Coast to Coast interview with Mel Waters called Mel's Hole. Well, Michael, for some unexplainable reason, I felt the Mel Waters interview might be vital to your research regarding the underground civilization J.C. Brown claimed to have found beneath Mount Shasta. You know, Raina, after listening to the interview, I knew you were right. And when I heard you say on the radio that you were planning an expedition up to Mount Shasta, I just had to meet you. Since moving here from Los Angeles, I have met many Native Americans who claim that the mountains in the Pacific Northwest are inhabited by underground beings. Well, that's exactly why I traveled 3,000 miles to get here. I'm eager to find out. Michael notices a white spotted cat with powder blue eyes coming towards him. Michael picks up the cat and pets it. I think he likes you. He doesn't go near anybody, Michael.
What's the cat's name, Raina?
His name is Marley. I named him after Bob Marley.
If you don't mind, Raina, I'm going to call him Marlito Jones.
Marlito Jones? Raina now bursts out hysterically in laughter.
Raina's laughter is interrupted by the ring of her cell phone. Raina picks up her cell phone from the counter and sits down at the kitchen table to talk. After finishing her telephone call, Raina turns to speak with Michael.
I just got a call from a medicine man named Bobby McCoy. He's a tribal elder from one of the local tribes. He called to tell me he needs to speak to you, Michael. He says it's important. I never even told him you were coming. I haven't spoken to Bobby McCoy in over 3 months.
McCoy is surprised by Raina's comment.
Raina's apartment later that evening. There is a knock on the front door. Raina gets up from her chair in the living room to answer the front door. McCoy turns to catch a glimpse of the man who is standing right outside of the door.
Hi, Bobby.
How are you doing, Raina?
Good, Bobby. Come on in.
Bobby McCoy, age 60, with long black hair and a ponytail, wearing glasses, with olive complexion, standing 6 foot tall, wearing a gray pullover sweatshirt with jeans and sneakers, walks into the living room.
Raina introduces McCoy to Bobby McCoy. Bobby, I'd like to introduce you to Michael McCoy.
McCoy gets up from his chair in the living room and shakes hands with Bobby McCoy.
My name's Bobby McCoy. Just call me Bobby. That's what everybody calls me.
Please, call me Michael. Raina told me that you'd be stopping over.
Raina and Bobby take a seat on the hardback chairs. McCoy takes a seat on a stool next to the kitchen.
Oh, Bobby, I haven't seen you for quite a while.
Yeah, it's been a couple of months.
The last time we spoke, you were getting over pneumonia. How are you feeling, Bobby?
Well, I'm better now.
I'm happy to hear that.
Bobby turns to speak to McCoy.
So, Michael, what brings you to Olympia?
I came out here because of a story that I've been researching about an ancient legend in California.
I see. So how did you and Raina meet?
I'll let Raina answer that question, Bobby. I heard Michael doing an interview on the radio and sent him an email. We started corresponding with one another and became friends.
Yeah, that's right there, Bobby. After about 3 months of emails and telephone conversations, I figured it was time that we should meet. So here I am.
Raina's a good woman. I've known her a very long time. She's been very active in the Native American community.
Yes, she's mentioned that to me, Bobby.
What legend are you referring to?
It's the legend of J.C. Brown, Bobby.
I don't think I've ever heard of it. What's the story about?
Well, the story's about a man named J.C. Brown who claims that while prospecting for gold in Mount Shasta, he stumbled upon a tunnel that led 12 miles into the mountain, where he found a village. In the village, he discovered skeletons and the remains of giants that were between 7 to 10 feet tall. These giants have lived underground for thousands of years.
The giants you're referring to do exist. We call them the Tall Ones. The Tall Ones are our descendants.
Bobby, have you or anyone in your family ever seen them?
My grandfather told me stories when I was young about seeing them fishing on the Nisqually River.
What do they look like, Bobby?
They look like Indians and have long black hair and stand about 8 to 9 feet tall. They wore buckskin.
So the stories are true.
I knew a woman that was raised by the Tall Ones. She would leave tobacco and food on a plate for them when they returned to the reservation.
What about Bigfoot, Bobby? Have you ever seen one?
I have a friend who lives near the Olympic National Forest. He has a smoker that he uses to cook salmon. Bigfoot, as you call him, has been frequently seen taking salmon out of his smoker. My friend had to modify the smoker by increasing the height of it and putting on a glass door. The reasons he did that was because Sasquatch would take the salmon out of the smoker before the salmon was done.
Did modifying the smoker help?
Yes. He hasn't had any problems since.
I always wondered, Bobby, why there weren't more sightings of Bigfoot.
They can materialize at will, so you can't see them.
You mean the Bering Strait theory is a lie?
Yes. We've been on this continent for thousands of years.
If the truth be known, it would destroy the paradigm our early European forefathers created, Bobby. Which also means that movie they're trying to peddle to our kids, Ice Age, is all bullshit. Raina now adds her thoughts into the mix. It's like Adolf Hitler said, the bigger the lie, the more believable it becomes. Their conversation is interrupted by the loud rumbling of a helicopter flying over the apartment. Raina opens the front door of her apartment. They all go outside to investigate. Staring at the helicopter, Marconi now comments, I've had helicopters, Bobby, follow me in New York, and now they're here.
My people have been under surveillance for over 500 years. We've had plenty of time to get used to it. Michael, you're either going to have to get used to it or find a way to fight back.
They all watch as the helicopters fly over the complex. Raina's apartment, Saturday morning. Raina and Marconi are sitting in the living room. I thought I'd take you downtown to see the State Capitol building. We can take a walk around the lake. Is that okay? That'll be nice. Maybe we can take some pictures too, Raina. Great. I'll get my camera and we can go. Raina goes into her bedroom to get her camera. When she returns, they both head out the front door. After a short 5-minute drive, Raina and Marconi get out of her silver Toyota and walk towards the Capitol Lake. Marconi can now see the Capitol Lake. He can also see the Olympia State Capitol building in the background. There are people walking and jogging around the lake. There are children with their parents sitting on park benches. Raina takes out her camera and begins to take photos of the lake with the state capitol in the background. I've always wanted to take a picture of the capitol. You couldn't have asked for a more perfect day, Raina. Marconi takes Raina's hand and they walk around the lake in a direction of the state capitol building. Michael, someone has tampered with my settings too. Someone must have gotten to the apartment while we were out. It sure looks that way, Raina. You better take a close look around. Raina walks over to her bedroom and enters the room. Within a few minutes, she returns holding a pair of cut-up panties.
Michael, someone's been through my clothes drawer and cut up my panties.
I think I better check out the guest room and see if any of my things are missing. Marconi walks from the living room into the guest bedroom and returns holding a penny. Marconi shows it to Raina.
Someone has left me a souvenir too, Raina. It's a penny that has been dented by a bullet. I think they're trying to send both of us a message.
Raina's apartment the following day. Raina and Marconi are talking in the living room.
Michael, I'm going to have to hang around waiting for the service tech to check out the computer.
Well, if you don't mind, Raina, I was thinking about taking the bus downtown to do a little sightseeing.
Matter of fact, no, that's a great idea, Michael. I'll see you when you get back.
Marconi kisses Raina goodbye and exits the apartment. Upon exiting the apartment, Marconi walks past another set of apartments where he notices two men observing him. One of the men is talking on his cell phone. Marconi focuses attention on a white van with the markings Goon Squad. As soon as Marconi reaches the bus stop, he observes a black helicopter overhead. The Olympia City bus arrives and passengers begin to board. Marconi is the last passenger to board. Corner of Division Avenue and Harrison Avenue. Marconi exits the Olympia City bus and walks to the corner. Marconi then waits for the light to change. Marconi is now crossing the street and he sees a Goon Squad van which is waiting for the light to change. Marconi recognizes the man driving the van. Marconi waves to the man as he crosses the street. The man pretends he doesn't see Marconi. Marconi now walks over to the downtown bus stop to get his connecting bus. As Marconi waits for his connecting bus, he is approached by a white man wearing a baseball cap carrying a backpack. The stranger, age approximately 45, wearing a green military jacket, engages Marconi in a conversation.
Can I bum a cigarette from you?
I'm sorry, I don't smoke.
I can tell by your accent you're not from around here, are you?
People around here don't take to strangers. Olympia is not a friendly town. You need to be careful, pal.
First off, we ain't pals, we ain't buddies, we ain't even friends. Are you threatening me?
Let's just say I'm giving you a warning. Before Marconi can answer, two men appear out of nowhere. The three men stare directly into Marconi's eyes.
Now let me give you a message for you and your boys to take back to your superiors. I don't scare easy. You can tell them that.
The downtown bus now arrives and Marconi waits in line with the other passengers to board the bus. The three men take a seat near the rear of the bus. Marconi watches the men like a hawk. When the bus reaches the downtown terminal, Marconi exits the bus with the rest of the passengers. Union Avenue and Capitol Way, downtown Olympia, Washington, the Subway sandwich shop. Marconi is sitting down with Raina having lunch, eating a sandwich. A white man wearing sunglasses and a black derby hat carrying a skateboard enters the store and walks up to the counter. Marconi observes the man as he studies the menu. The man puts his foot into the large garbage container next to the counter and compresses the contents in the can. Marconi watches as the man sits down to eat his lunch. Marconi whispers to Raina, and they both observe the man.
Raina, there's something strange about that guy.
Michael, are you sure you're not being a little paranoid because of what happened to you yesterday?
I got a bad feeling, Raina, about that guy.
Michael, you need to relax and just eat your lunch. The man wearing the sunglasses finishes his meal and walks over to the counter and picks up a newspaper. As he walks past Marconi and Raina, he stares back at them.
Raina, I'm telling you, there's something about to go down.
Michael, how can you be so sure?
Well, for one thing, Raina, he just changed seats and he's now sitting by the front window. I think he's a spotter.
The man glances up from his newspaper and stares again at Marconi and Raina.
That guy's got to be wearing a wire. He's listening to our conversations, Raina.
What do we do, Michael?
Well, Raina, as soon as we get outside, I'll tell you what we're going to do.
Okay, Michael.
Raina and Marconi finish their meal and exit the Subway shop.
Now on the corner of Union Avenue and Capitol Way, Marconi and Raina walk across the street to where her car is parked. Raina and Marconi both get into the car. Raina starts the engine and gets ready to pull away. Marconi motions with his right hand to wait. Marconi looks out the car window to see if it is safe to leave. Marconi sees a stranger with sunglasses and derby exiting the subway shop. The man, the spotter with the derby, signals men riding on bicycles. The stranger then gets on a skateboard and speeds away. The two men on bicycles, wearing helmets, look into Raina's car. Marconi opens the car door and jumps out of the car holding a large container of water. Raina, don't ask any questions. Just do what I say. I want you to drive to the corner and make a U-turn and meet me in the parking lot of a real estate building on 9th Street. Okay, Michael, I'll do it, but be careful. Marconi closes the car door and waits until Raina pulls away from the curb before walking away. Raina starts her engine and pulls away from the curb and makes a U-turn. As she waits at the traffic light to turn left onto Capitol Way, a red truck darts in front of her as she prepares to turn. Raina hits her brakes to avoid the collision. A bicyclist looks into Raina's car before speeding away. The bicyclist turns the corner and heads towards 9th Street. Marconi sees him and steps into the crosswalk. The bicyclist slams on his brakes to avoid hitting Marconi. Marconi throws the container of water all over the cyclist. The bicyclist makes a U-turn and quickly speeds away. Just a couple of minutes later, at the real estate office parking lot on 9th Street, Marconi walks over to Raina, who is standing next to her car. Raina is visibly shaken by her near-fatal experience. Michael, somebody just tried to slam into my car. Marconi puts his arms around Raina and holds her tightly. Marconi takes his hand and touches Raina's face as he stares into her eyes. Marconi now kisses Raina on her forehead. Cooper's Glen Apartments. Raina and Marconi get out of the silver Toyota and begin walking towards her apartment. Marconi notices two men watching them from a nearby apartment. Hey, Raina, there are two guys watching us. One of the guys was driving the Goon Squad van when I was harassed at the bus stop. Are you sure, Michael? Absolutely, Raina. Do you have your digital camera with you? Yes, Michael, it's in my bag. Good. I want you to take a picture of them and the van. Raina and Marconi turn and walk towards the two men who are having a cigarette in the doorway to their apartment. Hey, how you doing there? The two men ignore Marconi's greeting and avoid making eye contact. Raina takes photos of the men without their knowledge. Raina and Marconi continue walking. Raina checks her camera for the photos. Oh, great, Michael. I got the photo of the men and the license plates. Marconi smiles as they continue walking around the Cooper Glen Apartments complex. Back at Raina's apartment, Raina is sitting at her computer in the living room. Marconi is standing next to her looking at the computer screen. Michael, I downloaded the photos from the camera to my computer. Marconi studies the first photo before answering. Yeah, Raina. The young guy with the black baseball cap? He's the same guy I saw downtown. He looks Middle Eastern or Israeli, Michael. Yeah, he does, doesn't he? Now, let's just name him Moshe. Michael, take a look at the second guy and tell me who you think he looks like. Marconi studies the photo for a minute before answering. He looks just like Saddam Hussein. The resemblance is remarkable. Michael, you and I do think alike. That's exactly what I was thinking. Marconi and Raina laugh hysterically at the photos. Marconi and Raina's laughter is interrupted by the ring of Raina's cell phone. Raina picks up the phone and answers the call. Hi, Bobby. How are you? No, Michael and I are both all right. Neither one of us were hurt. Thanks for checking on us, Bobby. We'll see you later. Raina puts down the phone and turns to speak to Marconi. Michael, Bobby knows what happened to us today. But how could he, Raina? He just does, Michael. How do you think he does it, Raina? All I can tell you is that any time I've ever been sick, he's called me to ask me how I'm feeling. You know, Raina, I sensed his powers when we were at the sweat lodge. Raina raises her hand towards the ceiling and looks up. Bobby's always told me that he's supposed to protect me. He's never told me why. I've never questioned Bobby about it. Raina shrugs her shoulders and smiles. Raina's apartment, Saturday morning. Marconi is sitting in the dining room finishing off breakfast. Raina picks up the dishes and rinses them off in the sink before putting them into the dishwasher. Michael, there's a mysterious place called the Maima Mounds that I'd like to take you to today. Some say the mounds are ancient Indian burial grounds. You know, Raina, that sounds very interesting. So how far is it from here? It's only 20 miles from here. It's located in Little Rock, right off I-5 on Waddle Creek Road. Well, anytime you're ready. I'm ready to go whenever you are, Raina. Raina grabs her bag from the front door. Marconi and Raina exit the apartment. 30 minutes later, Maima Mounds, Little Rock, Washington. Marconi and Raina get out of the silver Toyota in the Natural Area Preserve parking lot. They walk through a wooded area before reaching the prairie mounds. Marconi can see large cedar trees with mounds at their bases. He sees a nearby building with an observation deck. There are prairie mounds surrounding an open field. Raina stops at a large cedar tree and places both of her hands on it. She stands there for a while, meditating in silence. Marconi continues walking and gravitates to a large mound that is buried under a large tree. Marconi now walks up the incline to the top of the sacred mound, and he stands in front of the tree. After a few moments, he notices a red envelope on the ground. Marconi picks up the red Chinese envelope, opens the envelope, and pulls out 3 coins. Marconi studies the coins. Marconi then observes a black military helicopter overhead. He quickly puts the red envelope back into his pocket. Raina now observes the helicopter and walks over to where Marconi is standing. Michael, looks like we've got company. Yeah, it's Aegon and O'Rourke again. They're back. Raina and Marconi hear shots being fired from a nearby firing range. It now begins to rain. Michael, it's starting to rain. Well, what do you want to do, Raina? Well, let's make our way back to the car, Michael. That's a good idea. It looks like it could come down hard any moment. Raina and Marconi look out over the prairie as they hurry back to the car in a Natural Area Preserve parking lot. Raina and Marconi get back into her vehicle. Raina starts the vehicle and proceeds to leave the Maima Mounds Preserve parking lot. Raina now turns left onto 128th Street Southwest and sees signs for the I-5 interstate. She then merges onto the interstate and heads north back towards Olympia. Michael, something's wrong with the brakes. Well, try tapping on the brakes, Raina. Raina taps on the brake pedal. Michael, the pedal went completely to the floor. You know, Raina, I can hear a grinding sound coming from the front wheels. Michael, I just had the car inspected a couple of months ago, and they told me the brakes were fine. Raina, get in the right lane and drive slowly, please. Okay, Michael. Raina checks her rearview mirror before changing lanes. You know, Raina, this car isn't safe. Is there a place we can take the car to have it looked at? Yes, Michael. There's a place downtown called Les Schwab Automotive. Good. Let's go straight there. Raina now drives slowly on Interstate 5 heading towards Olympia. She exits on Capitol Way and heads down on a city street driving towards the automotive parking lot. Raina now pulls her car into the automotive parking lot and the car screeches to a halt inches from the main window of the Les Schwab Automotive store. A white male auto mechanic wearing a blue uniform comes running out of the Les Schwab Automotive building.
Don't tell me! Let me guess! You're here because you need a new set of brakes.
Raina and Marconi now step out of the car. Raina hands the auto mechanic her car keys. Raina's cell phone rings and she answers the call. After a couple of seconds, she hangs up the cell phone.
Michael, that was Bobby McCoy. He asked if we were okay. He said that he needs to come over tonight.
Raina, how did he know that we were in danger? Raina shrugs her shoulders and Marconi just stares. Later that afternoon, Raina's apartment. Bobby McCoy is shaking a ceremonial rattle and waving it around Raina and Marconi's body. Bobby then walks through each room of Raina's apartment, shaking the rattle.
Can you get me an ashtray? I'm going to burn some sage.
Raina walks over to the kitchen counter and picks up an ashtray and hands it to Bobby. Bobby goes into his pocket and takes out a plastic bag. He pours the sage into the ashtray and lights it with a match.
There are people who are trying to cause you both harm.
Can you tell me why, Bobby?
Michael, They want something that you have.
What is it that we're supposed to have, Bobby?
You'll know it when you see it.
Bobby, that sounds like a riddle.
The walls have ears. We need to talk outside.
Bobby Raina and Marconi exit the apartment. Marconi is holding a large plastic fork in his right hand. Outside of the Cooper's Glen apartment complex, Bobby McCoy, Raina, and Marconi begin walking around the development. As they begin walking, Bobby observes his surroundings.
There are many people living here that are watching you.
Do you know who they are, Bobby?
Raina, I will show you.
Bobby stops in front of the apartment building directly across the street and begins by saying,
There is a woman with blonde hair and a man that have been following you when you leave to go to work.
You know, I always see their car leaving when I go to work, Bobby.
Bobby stops in front of the next set of apartment buildings and begins by saying,
These are two men who live here in this apartment who have been listening to all of your conversations.
You know, I knew it, Bobby. I knew it. I knew it. I knew it. I knew it.
Raina, you must listen to Marconi. He knows what he's talking about.
Michael, you are right, Michael. You are right all the time.
The door now opens to the apartment across the street, and both of the men, who had been watching Marconi and Raina, walk outside to have a cigarette. Bobby, Raina, and Marconi continue walking.
Those two men, they have been listening to your conversations. They are curious. They want to know what you are doing.
Then they must know why you're here, Bobby.
Indians make them nervous.
Marconi turns and faces the men and shakes the large plastic fork in their direction. The men stare back with fear in their eyes, and then Marconi yells out, Boom shakalaka laka, boom shakalaka laka, boom shakalaka laka, boom! The two men quickly put out their cigarettes and head back into their apartment. Bobby McCoy, Raina, and Marconi try to hold back their laughter.
Would you look at their faces? They look like two deer that have been caught in the headlights, Michael.
Michael, you are a practical joker.
Yeah, Bobby, just call me Marconi Wolf.
Bobby McCoy, Raina, and Marconi all turn to make sure no one is watching them. When they see that no one is watching, they all break out into hysterical laughter. Cooper's Glen apartment complex early the next morning. Marconi is taking a walk and sees the blonde woman getting into their car, preparing to drive away. Marconi quickly walks over to the apartment complex exit and stops in the middle of the street, blocking the path of the couple's car. Marconi stands in front of the car like a statue. The couple stares at one another in disbelief. Marconi now slowly walks up to the driver's window and smiles. The car proceeds slowly to the exit and stops. The couple takes another look back at Marconi. Marconi now walks over to the couple's apartment and sprinkles a handful of Cheerios in front of their door, leaving his calling card. Raina's apartment, midday. Marconi looks out the dining room window and sees a U-Haul moving truck parked in front of the couple's apartment. Marconi takes Raina's digital camera and goes outside. As he's outside, Marconi sees the couple loading things into the back of their car. As Marconi gets closer, he takes out the camera and takes a picture of the man and the woman. The woman is a bodybuilder, age 40, and she catches Marconi as he snaps the photo.
What are you doing taking our pictures? Marconi points to the roof of their apartment. I'm taking photos of the two old crows on your roof.
The couple run back into the apartment. Marconi walks back into Raina's apartment. Raina's apartment later that afternoon. Marconi looks out the dining room window and sees the man bodybuilder loading the U-Haul moving truck. Marconi watches as the blonde woman is carrying things over to the dumpster that sits in front of Raina's apartment. Marconi now walks out of Raina's apartment, opens a gate to the dumpster, and picks up a microwave from on top of the dumpster. He carries the microwave back up to the apartment.
Hey, Raina, I have a present for you.
Raina walks out from her bedroom and checks out the microwave.
Where did you get that, Michael?
The couple across the street left it by the dumpster with the trash.
This microwave is brand new, Michael. I wonder what else they've thrown out.
I don't know, Raina. I'm going to go downstairs and find out. Marconi walks out of Raina's apartment, opens the gate to the dumpster, and Marconi lifts the lid to the dumpster. Marconi finds a stereo system with speakers. Marconi places the equipment in front of the gate. Marconi then carries the stereo equipment up to Raina's apartment.
Check this out, Raina. I've got a complete surround sound stereo system with a DVD player. Michael, it looks brand new.
Yeah, Raina. I even found all the wires to hook it up.
Michael, why are they throwing away brand new electronic equipment?
I don't know, Raina, but I think it may have something to do with me taking their pictures today.
Bobby was right about that couple, Michael.
Yeah, I'm going back downstairs to see what else I can find.
Okay, Michael. Raina stands by the front door and watches Michael as he rummages through the open dumpster.
Michael bends over into the dumpster, hanging upside down. The couple returns to the dumpster and sees Marconi dangling. The couple gets back into their car and drive away. Marconi sees the couple as they speed away. Marconi picks up a stack of papers and then carries the papers back up to Raina's apartment. Marconi puts the stack of papers on the kitchen counter. He then goes through the stack of papers one by one.
Raina, would you take a look at this?
Marconi hands Raina a stack of photos to look through.
Michael, these photos are of people that live in our apartment complex.
Keep looking, Raina. Let me know if there's anyone you recognize. Raina searches through the pile of photos and finds the photos of people she recognizes.
Michael, they've got our photos too.
Yeah, I know.
That's why they came back to the dumpster, Michael.
Yeah, they didn't want us to find them, Raina. Raina and Marconi are interrupted by the knock on the front door. Raina does not open the door. She goes over to the bedroom window to see who is standing outside her door.
Michael, it's the same man living in the next apartment that Bobby said was watching us at the door.
He wants you to open the door so he can see exactly what I took out of the dumpster.
Michael, they'll probably be back to check the dumpster later.
Yeah, when they do, I'll have a surprise waiting for them.
I'm sure you will, Michael.
Marconi hooks up the stereo surround system and places it into Raina's entertainment center.
Raina, can you hand me a CD so I can test out the system?
Raina hands Marconi a Phil Oaks CD to play. Marconi puts the CD into the tray and hits the play button.
Wow, listen to that sound.
Wow, Michael, that sound is amazing.
Yeah, isn't it, Raina?
Boy, Michael, Christmas came a little early this year.
Raina and Marconi sit down in the living room and listen to the song playing on the surround sound system.
Raina's apartment, 11 p.m. later that evening. Marconi and Raina are sitting in the living room. Marconi bends over to whisper something into Raina's ear. Raina gets up and returns with a rope and scissors. Marconi sneaks down the stairs of the apartment. Marconi ties the rope around the dumpster gate. Marconi makes a knot and cuts the rope with the scissors. Marconi then returns back to the apartment. Raina's apartment, 12 midnight. Marconi and Raina look out the window and see a strange car parked next to the dumpster. A man gets out of the car and walks into the apartment of the bodybuilder couple.
Marconi now whispering,
"That guy is going to wait until you and I are asleep before he tries to look into the dumpster, Raina."
"Boy, won't he be surprised, Michael, when he can't open the gate."
"Yeah, Raina. I can't wait till I see the reaction on his face."
Raina and Marconi cover their mouths as they break out in laughter. Raina's apartment, 3 a.m. A shadow of the man can be seen as he tries to open the dumpster gate. The gate is making a clanging sound. Raina and Marconi are standing by the window laughing hysterically as the man is unable to force open the dumpster gate. The man jumps back into his car and quickly drives away from the apartment complex.
Raina's apartment, the next evening. Marconi hangs up the cell phone and turns to talk to Raina, who is sitting in the living room.
"Raina, my mother has been rushed to the hospital with pneumonia, and my brother is due to be discharged from the hospital, and I'm the only one who can go to sign him out."
"When are you leaving, Michael?"
"I'll be leaving tomorrow, Raina."
Bushwick Public Library. Marconi is standing talking to Officer Lopez, who has been listening attentively to the entire story.
"Michael, whatever happened to the coins you found at the Mima Mounds?"
Marconi pulls out a white envelope from his coat pocket.
"I put it in a self-addressed white envelope and sent it to myself in New York." Marconi now opens the envelope and pulls out a red Chinese envelope within the other envelope and shows the coin to Officer Lopez. It's a 1943 Franklin D. Roosevelt dime. Yes, Lopez, but Roosevelt didn't die until April 1945. The United States Mint doesn't create a coin until after the death of a president. This coin is not supposed to exist. Wow, Marconi. This could explain why you're being followed. Officer Lopez looks around the library before handing back the Franklin D. Roosevelt dime. Yeah, Lopez, I'm going into the city today to see a rare coin dealer. Marconi places the coin back into his pocket and waves goodbye to Officer Lopez before exiting the library. Stack's Rare Coin Dealers, West 57th Street, New York City. Marconi opens the front door to the shop and walks to a display counter where a man is standing. Walter Shelby, age 45, with dark hair and glasses, wearing a brown suit with matching tie, warmly greets Marconi.
My name is Walter Shelby. How may I help you? I have a coin that I would like to have appraised. I can help you with that. May I see the coin?
Marconi takes the coin from his pocket and shows it to the coin dealer. The coin dealer studies it for a moment and then asks,
"Where did you get this coin, sir?" "Why is that important?" "There are 5 United States Mint facilities in the United States. None of them use a B marking on its coins. Can you excuse me for a moment? I need to talk to one of our experts."
Marconi takes the coin from the dealer and puts it back into his pocket. Marconi watches as Walter Shelby talks to an older man standing in the rear of the shop. The older man picks up the telephone and immediately calls someone. Marconi senses trouble and quickly exits the front door of the shop. New York Public Library, 42nd Street, second floor information desk. Marconi is talking to a woman at the information desk.
"Can you please tell me where the rare books department is located?"
"It's across the hall, sir, in room 202.
"Thanks."
Marconi walks into the rare books department. A librarian hands Marconi a book. Marconi reads the book and then takes out his cell phone camera and clicks a photo. Marconi runs down the stairs to the first floor and exits the library. Once outside of the New York Public Library, Marconi walks to the corner to hail a taxi cab. He sees the Flynn brothers. He looks across the street and sees Tootie Muldoon running towards him. Marconi takes off running down 42nd Street. He now sees a black helicopter flying directly overhead. There are crowds of people walking on the sidewalk. Marconi cuts through Bryant Park. He sees the 4 agents looking around, talking to one another. Marconi then swipes a subway pass at the turnstile and runs down the stairs to catch the train. The train pulls into the station and Marconi boards the train. Marconi laughs as the crowded train leaves the station. Knoll Street Apartments. Marconi is sitting in his bedroom on the computer wearing a set of headphones.
"Hi, Raina. It's Michael."
"How's everything in New York, Michael?"
"Not good, Raina. I've been followed by agents and helicopters all day. Do you remember when I asked you where I could mail a letter?"
"Yes, Michael."
"Well, when we went to the Mima Mounds, I found a red Chinese envelope with coins in it."
"You mean like the coins Mel Waters found on his property?"
"Exactly, Raina. I didn't make the connection until I listened to the Mel's whole CD again."
"Oh, you mean the one that I sent you?"
"I had a feeling that that CD would have something to do with your research regarding the Mel's whole hollow earth theory."
"After listening to the CD again, I remembered the letter that I mailed to myself in New York. When I looked at the coin, I noticed that it was the same 1943 Franklin D. Roosevelt dime that Mel Waters talked about in his appearance on Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell."
"That's the same dime Mel Waters found in his property."
"Yes, that's exactly right, Raina. When I discovered that, I took the dime to the Stack's coin dealer, and they acted very strangely when I showed it to them. The man wanted to know where I had found it. The next thing I knew, I was being chased by agents when I came out of the New York Public Library."
"Michael, they know you have the coin."
"Yes, Raina, they certainly do. The Roosevelt dime even has the B marking on it. They're going to try to confiscate the coin, Michael, just like they did to Mel Waters, and the guys who visited him were Treasury officials."
This coin, Raina, may be proof of a parallel universe.
Richard Hoagland called during the original broadcast and said normal time travel could not explain what Mel Waters talked about, but there is one thing that could, and that was a parallel universe.
That's exactly right, Raina. Yes, I agree. A parallel universe.
Hoagland went on to say that there could be a universe in which similar things occurred, but with different outcomes. A lot of our best scientists are saying this may very well be the case. You know, Raina, there could be a universe in which the Nazis won the war.
Yes, Michael, and the B marking on the coin could stand for Berlin.
Yes, Raina, and that might explain Admiral Byrd's secret diary regarding meeting advanced beings with flying machines in the center of the Earth.
Michael, that could also explain why someone didn't want you to search for the tunnel under Mount Shasta that leads to an ancient Lemurian civilization.
Yes, Raina, this is all making perfect sense now.
Michael, you are connecting the dots. That's what they're afraid of. That's why they've gone to great lengths to try and stop you from finding out the truth.
Yes, Raina. I know now what Bobby McCoy meant when he said, "You'll know the answer when you see it."
McConey picks up the 1943 Franklin D. Roosevelt dime and holds it in the palm of his hand and stares at it for a moment.
Michael, the answer is right in front of you.
Yes, Raina. The way to the answer is to evaluate everything and everyone. Don't accept it just because it is true. Accept 50% of what you hear and investigate the rest.
Yes, Michael. It seems like your journey has taken you a long way.
Raina, I have traveled many miles and have met so many beautiful people along the way. I have discovered that we have more in common than I could have ever imagined. I have gained valuable insight from my time spent with you and Bobby McCoy. The life lesson experiences I have gained are priceless.
You know, Michael, I am very touched.
Raina, we have come here with the answers. We blind ourselves to the answers. Most people spend a lifetime and never figure it out.
Michael, that is very profound wisdom.
Raina, the answers are within all of us. All we have to do is choose to see.
It is so complex yet so simple. You are what you believe. I believe the war is over. I believe that sunshine will follow rain and everything will work out.
Your beliefs are what you are.
At the Nisqually Reservation, Bobby McCoy is standing in front of a large crowd gathered holding a bullhorn in his right hand. Bobby looks around before addressing the crowd.
Now hear this. Will the last Native American turn off the lights on the reservation before leaving?
Fort Lewis Main Gate Visitor Center. At the Fort Lewis base, helicopters can be seen throughout the base lined up in formation. The Flynn brothers are throwing metal into a pile. Aegon and O'Rourke are holding a shovel. Tootie and Muldoon are collecting metal. There are signs posted that read, "Scrap metal for sale." Woody Wilcox can be seen standing over the men.
Woody Wilcox has returned from Alabama with the chip removed from his head, and he is now in charge of all the military facilities.
Listen up, you maggots! I'm in charge now. Don't you knuckleheads understand? I can't hear you.
Yes, sir.
Washington, D.C., Capitol Building of the United States. A large crowd is gathered at the Lincoln Monument. Robert Marconi is wearing glasses, dressed in a suit. Robert Marconi is holding up his right hand. Jerry the Super, Officer Lopez, and Hammer are standing in the front of the crowd, waiting for Robert's speech. Robert Marconi steps up to the podium to address the large crowd gathered to witness his first inaugural speech.
As your newly elected president, I promise to stop all wars and bring all the troops stationed abroad home. It's about time we mind our own damn business. And now that I'm president, I plan to eliminate taxes from A to Z. No more automobile tax, no more city tax, no more tax on your driver's license, no more tax on education, no more federal tax, no more sales tax, no more tax on YOU, no more taxes. Every child will have a free college education. Every American will have free health insurance. Cigarettes will be now 50 cents a pack. Gasoline prices will be $1 a gallon. Screw them big oil companies. The buck stops here, now that I'm president. As soon as the buck stops here, the Federal Reserve Bank is now closed. The new government will back its currency with gold and silver. We will reinstate Executive Order number 11110 that was signed June 4, 1963 by President Kennedy. And while I'm on the subject of closings, we're going to close the National Security Agency, the FBI, the CIA, and Homeland Security. And lastly, all the individuals who are responsible for the surveillance of my brother Michael Marconi will be going to prison. Somebody's got to go to prison. Somebody's got to pay. Somebody's got to go to prison.
There are signs posted that read, "Welcome to Mount Shasta." There's a large crowd gathered wearing backpacks. Marconi and Rayner are standing in front of Mount Shasta. Marconi prepares to address a large crowd that is gathered there. We are about to make history today. Our civil engineers have found the entrance that leads to the tunnel that will take us to the lost civilization of Lemuria. Marconi is interrupted by Rayner. Rayner points to a man in the crowd wearing a beard.
"Michael, either that's Willie Nelson in the crowd or Mel Waters has joined the expedition and given someone from the Men in Black the finger."